So I'm actually going to start with a short 3-minute excerpt from a video I did in 2013 called Service of the Goods. So we'll start with that, and then I'll stop dropping things and get into other things. So this is a JPEG of Nicophorus Lateria's Antigone in front of the dead Polynices from the National Gallery of in Athens. In the Greek myth, Antigone is one of the four children of Oedipus, and his mother Iocasta, the others being her brother Eteocles, Polynices, and her sister Ismene. Latre's dramatic painting is a source for the JPEG, that is the source for this JPEG, depicts Antigone's discovery of her brother's body after a civil war over the throne of Thebes, after the banishment of Oedipus, and fought between sides supporting both of the male heirs. Both Polynices and Eteocles die in the. Antigone defies Creon and performs a ritual burial for Polynices. For her adherence to family duty, in disobedience of his sovereign power, Creon decrees that Antigone is to be buried alive in a cave. Recognizing his fault in leaving Polynices unburied, and condemning Antigone, Creon buries Polynices' body, actually buries Polynices' body, and attempts to free Antigone once she has been in the cave. Upon entering the cave, Creon finds his own son, Haemon, who is betrothed to Antigone, or she is betrothed to him, lamenting over her body. She has hung herself. Next slide. Oops. That battery's too good now. this JPEG is a Henry Fuseli drawing, Haman discovering the body of Antigone from 1800, from the Huntington Library Art Collection in San Marino, California. Antigone has hung herself in a cave. Haman stabs himself in grief. Eurydice, Creon's wife, commits suicide upon hearing of her son's death. And Creon is left a broken sovereign. Right? Tragedy. Antigone was evoked by Jacques Lacan as a central allegorical figure in his seventh series of annual weekly seminars in 1959, entitled The Ethics of Psychoanalysis. In his discussion, Lacan positions Antigone as a model of ethical conduct. In her act of burying Polynices, she attends to her responsibilities and most importantly, acts according to her desire. Her actions are not driven by ego, but rather by desire. And for Lacan, desire is always the desire of the other. That is, desire is always the desire to be the object of another's desires, to be recognized by the other. When sentenced to a living death in the cave, Antigone accepts her fate, plunges headlong into it. She illuminates the fundamental drive behind desire, the death drive. After all, in Lacan's return to Freud, all drives are death drives because they seek to complete themselves. This is another JPEG, a capture from the English subtitled version of George Savelle's Antigone from 1961. And I'm going to play a clip from that. It's about 3 minutes long as well. So can we play that?
Τα μυρολόγια και οι θρύνοι αναφελούσαν τους μελφάνατους, δεν θα πάβαν ποτέ. Πάρτε τη γρήγορα. Κλείστε τη στον πέτρινο τάφο της όπως διέταξα και παρατάτε τη έρημη και μοναχή. Και αν θέλει ας πεθάνει, αν θέλει ας ζήσει κλεισμένη εκεί μέσα. Έτσι ούτε εμείς θα έχουμε το κρίμα της, μα ούτε εκείνη θα ξανάρθει ποτέ στον απάνω κόσμο.
Νηφικό κρεβάτι. Παντοτινή μου υπόγεια κατοικία. Σημώνει η ώρα που θα συναντήσω τους δικούς μου στο βασίλειο των νεκρών. Εκεί που η Περσεφόνη τόσους και τόσους δέχτηκε από τη γενιά μου. Στέρνη τώρα φτάνω κι εγώ με τέτοιο φοβερό τρόπο. Πριν ζήσω τα χρόνια που θα έπρεπε. Μα αν φτάσω, ελπίζω να είμαι ευπρόσδεκτη κοντά σου, πατέρα μου. Και σε σένα, μητέρα μου. Και σε σένα, πολύ αγαπημένη μου αδερφέ. Γιατί με κρούσα, εγώ σας έλωσα και σας στόλισα με τα χέρια μου. Και έρανα τους τάφους σας με σπονδές. Μα να πως πληρώνουμε τώρα, Πολυνίκη, που φρόντισα το σώμα σου. Έρμη και σκότεινη την άμυρη με θάβουνε ζωντανή. Ποιο νόμο των θεών πάτησα. Και γιατί πρέπει πια η δυστυχισμένη να ελπίζω στους θεούς. Ποιο να φωνάξω να με βοηθήσει αφού με την ευσέβειά μου δεν κέρδισα τίποτα παραπάνω. Παρά να με τιμωρούνε τώρα σαν τον πιο ασεβή. Α, όχι. Αν στους θεούς φαίνεται δίκαιη η τιμωρία μου. Μετανιώνω για ό,τι έκανα σαν αμαρτωλή. Αν όμως οι αμαρτωλοί είναι αυτοί που με τιμωρούνε, Ας μην πάθουν περισσότερα κακά από όσα κάνουν τώρα σε μένα.
We'll just hold it there for a second. So Antigone denounces her remorseful relationship to what Lacan refers to or calls a service of the goods. That is, she rebukes her attachment to Creon's sovereign law and its ease and satisfaction in the proper ordered flow of power, material consumption, and the appending social ideals. She exemplifies Lacan's paradigms in psychoanalysis, where, importantly, the only thing of which one can be guilty of is having given ground in relation to one's desire. For Lacan, through Antigone, the only ethical paradigm is, have you acted in conformity with the desire that is in you? Here, stuck in the cave, Antigone suffers two deaths, existing in a space between them, an actual mortal death of the material self and a symbolic death. By not adhering to a service of the goods, she is cast out of the underworld. Outside of sovereign rule and its rights and protections, she is removed from the symbolic orders of power. Her subject position in its social identity is denied. She no longer exists for the other. She becomes Giorgio Agamben's homo sacer, that figure of bare life, or perhaps Hegel's concealed animal of captivity, not world-forming as a human, not worldless as a stone, or what Eric L. Santner has called the creaturely. But prior to this definitive mortality, at the point when Antigone decides to act ethically, to bury her brother, to act out her desire, at that point, she enters into a liminal state, what Lacan's students baptized as a zone between two deaths. In this zone, at the cusp of her death, Antigone's subjectivity could not be more precise. She could never see it more defined. It is the point of the materialization of her ethics. This zone between two deaths could be likened to what Slavoj Žižek, in his dialectical materialist allegory to the parallax error in optics, has, borrowing from Alain Badeau and Gilles Deleuze, called a minimal difference. That essential interior gap in an object where its material existence and its experience as lived, there's a gap. It is the space of subjectivity. That is where it's formed, in that gap between the material and the experience of that material. As Žižek states, materialism is not the direct assertion of my inclusion into objective reality. It rather resides in the reflexive twist by means of which I am included in the picture. I myself am included in the picture constituted by me. It is this reflexive short circuit, this necessary redoubling of myself as standing outside and inside my picture, that bears witness to my material existence. Oops. I'm focusing this discussion on the productive tension between the still and moving imagery through my experience of working through digital data streams. That is, digital archives, commercial websites such as Getty Images and Associated Press, and common image interfaces such as Google Images, YouTube, or Tumblr, databases that include still images, moving images, text, acoustic materials, and code. Savelli's film stars the Greek actress and singer Irene Pappas, famous for The Guns of Navarro, Zorba the Greek, Zed, but also for playing famous figures of Greek antiquity, Helen in the Women of Troy, Antigone, and Electra. These are JPEGs of an original analog publicity photograph of Pappas from MGM from 1955. In the photographs, she wears the same off-the-shoulder dress and poses in front of a white painted brick wall. I'm interested in many things in this pairing, and most of the significance I attribute to them comes from their boundaries. I think, as Leslie was saying, that space in between something, this kind of figure-ground relationship, those barriers, their contiguities, the editorial decisions within them, both separately and as a pair, right? What the authors have chosen, what the photographer has chosen, what the individual user has chosen online to focus on. This is what, you know, photo editors used to do and that we do as a common part of our practice, our part of our existence online now. I have often thought of the data stream as this zone between two deaths, where ethics and subjectivity emerge. The essential gap between the erosion of the physical material, the negation of an object, the object substance of a silver gelatin photograph or a celluloid film, for instance, and the removal from the symbolic order of that substance, the ineffable, tangential, the metonymic, the deferred. The online material is often denigrated as immaterial, even if untrue. Oops. So this is another, so those are images of foxes that I've found, these incredible images of these foxes frozen in lakes. And then this incredible video, of course, that I stumbled across in searching for those, of this fox frozen by a windstorm. So if we could play that. So again, I'm thinking about this image stream that I work in, that many of us work in, as this zone between two deaths, this zone where it is both the death of the material of the substance, but the death of its kind of symbolic meaning in the world, and it becomes the ineffable. And that is that zone where ethics is played out. The form of the works that I make develops through a dialectic testing of shared and appropriated imagery and sound. In my practice, and this is primarily nonfiction material, the images and objects that I create pose questions about the limits of representation by examining complex associations between found photographs, found in shared photographs, videos, sounds, and sounds from documentaries, photojournalism, and online media streams. I select, catalog, and compile imagery and audio intuitively. From this indexing, I identify and isolate details, manipulating them via editing and compositing. My methodology attempts to reveal and conditions of desire in representation and the subordination of what is revealed to conventions of production and reception. This productive tension between the senseless unknowing of one's desires and the laws imparted to mitigate and corral the symptoms that desire or, of that desire erupts in the editorial process that frames representation. My editorial determinations in, sorry, my my authorial choices, such as medium, duration, color, sound, and are editorial determinations in a large, corporate and increasingly surveilled system of organizational processes that include the decisions of others and mark traces of their subjectivities through actions such as selection, sampling, augmentation, and contextualization. In my work, I exploit this array of representational production to understand how retinal and oral or other phenomenological sensations can be structured to denote desire through a governing ethic. This formation of ethics is what I consider my primary material. This idiosyncratic indexing of subjectivities through their manifestation in the material practices is an ethical act. As with Antigone, I am acting in conformity with the desire that is within me, which is the desire for the desire of the other. So this is a project that I did in 2010. And I was interested in these images of the Madrid train bombings, and specifically this image here, where we have first responders on the scene doing something within the photograph that is really incredible. So they're protecting the rights of the image of the dead, but at the same time, they are there to block out the image. So the image becomes, the photographer's image becomes this site of nothingness, the site of blocking out. And so I began to restage these images in studio. And this is a series called Rags. And I was interested in this barrier, this kind of this thing, this kind of structure that stands in for the ethical, the ethics of a kind of relationship. Oops. And this is them displayed here at the power plant, 2012, I believe. This is another series called Figure Ground. And these are gouache paintings. They are interpretations, they are translations of pre-existing material that I've found online as well. So, for the instance, these are images that hung with me for some reason, irked me either desirously or I felt them incredibly horrific. These are UN forensic workers working on a mass grave in Srebrenica. And I couldn't understand how I could communicate best to an audience or to another my desire is a strange word in this, but my desire to look at the other's desire, how cropping works, how an image is read by me. So it is both desire, but it's both repulsion at the same time. How do I do that? And it was about looking at an image and translating it into something that was optically jarring. It was this simple translation, but one based on looking at the image, analyzing the image, looking at its Barthian punctum, right, or what might be there as an underlying thing for the residue of that, and then beginning another structural, a translation from there. So a very different image, right? One of desire versus one of repulsion. Another image. Again, I'm having relationships with this image of a young man murdered in a bombing in Gaza, about my age at the time I was making this, really beautiful, looking directly at the camera with this kind of blanket coming up to kind of conceal the scene. And having problems dealing with this image, having problems having it stick with me as images do, how do I relate that? How do I kind of give that trace back? Sorry. So the video that I showed at the beginning was part of the work that I did around the work of Frederick Wiseman, the documentary filmmaker from the United States, working primarily from the late 60s to present, creating one film mainly every second year. Wiseman goes in and for a kind of period of 6 months, looks at state-run tax-funded organizations, welfare offices, hospitals, police stations, and creates observational documentaries where he does not react with the subjects in the scene. And he creates so they're institutional documentaries. I'm interested in the structure of his work. I'm interested in Wiseman as an institution himself. And so I wanted to recreate this work. And again, it was a filtering through of this process of looking at his works, looking at all of them, creating a database of those things, finding the traces of his subjectivity, his desires, mapping his biases onto mine in many ways. As Wiseman says, all aspects of documentary filmmaking involve choice and are therefore manipulative. But the ethical aspects of it is that you have to try to make a film that is true to the spirit of the sense of what is going on. My view is that these films are biased, prejudiced, and condensed, compressed but fair. I think what I do is to make movies that are not accurate in any objective sense, but accurate in the sense that I think that they are a fair account of the experience that I had in making the movie. So within this image stream that I'm constantly working in, within the kind of database of film, images, code, data, I'm looking for the residue, the trace of the other, the trace of their desire. And that could be a biased, prejudiced whatever that thing is, and I'm mapping my own onto there and creating from there. I think I'll just play for the last 10 minutes, hopefully. I don't think I have that much, but the last video. So I'm just going to scroll ahead to it. It's a video called "The Innocents" that I made in response to a lot of these questions of ethics, but also about the image stream itself, how we work out of it, using Truman Capote as a kind of central figure for in relationship to nonfiction. And I'll just play it, and maybe we can talk about it after. So.
Thank you.